Oh, my, one of my new prized possessions, dude. You know, me and Dave Navarro are best friends now. So look at that, dude.
Whoa.
That's a one and only, dude. And he only had it for a couple months, and then he got rid of it because he needed some fast money back in the early 90s. Ha ha. How are you, darling?
Very good.
Perfect. I have my English accent. Good.
Tell you what, that's not bad.
Well, you know, I've want all American musicians want to be English musicians.
Really?
Well, yeah. And it's kind of like, yeah, that's the swap. All the English musicians in the, you know, mid 60s, early 60s, Jeff Beck's and your Jimmy Pages and all them, they just wanted to be American musicians, kind of, you know what I mean? And the blues and all that stuff. And now, and then in the 70s and the 80s, we all just wanted to be English musicians.
Okay.
So, like, you know, if the Stones visited Chicago, they had to go to Chess Records, you know? When I come to London, I have to go to Trident Studios.
I see. That makes sense.
Yeah. I mean, it makes total sense. We had to relearn it from you guys.
Well, we've got good heritage over here, haven't we, to be fair? Musical heritage. Well,
exactly. I mean, you know, you guys took it and then put classical in it and everything else. And then that's when my generation went, oh, you know, we love the Queen. We love the Led Zeppelin and we love the Beatles and we love the Stones, you know.
Well, okay.
It's always interesting. I mean, that the first wave of the English rock and roll was such a cool thing because it had the dandiness of English and that kind of well-spokenness of it, you know, and then with kind of guttural sort of, I don't know, it was perfect, you know.
No, I know what you mean. Perfect,
it was perfectly sent back and forth.
I know what you mean. Actually, I was going to say.
I would say that 90s alternative rock of, you know, from Jane's Addiction to Nirvana to all of those bands were kind of, that was them going back to England, sort of, you know.
Yeah, for sure.
With Zeppelin and also, you know, all of the great post-punk stuff that came out of Magazine. You know, it's endless. It's freaking endless.
Well, I feel like there's a, you know, a real sort of classic rock sort of feel on the new album, actually. I was getting quite a bit of that when I was listening to it.
I mean, it hasn't really always been. I mean, when I heard the Foo Fighters my first time, and I heard Fingernails Are Pretty, Fingernails Are, this is a call. I was playing with Alanis Morissette, and I was like, this sounds like if Steve Miller was, you know, had Bad Brains as his backing band or something like that. You know what I mean? So there's always, that's who we are for sure as musicians, is we're just, our musical DNA is everything from, you know, Bee Gees to Black Flag and everything in between, you know. Not me personally on the Black Flag, but Dave definitely.
Oh, big time, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And and, you know, and that's classic rock now, you know. I mean, yeah, we've always been classic rock with a little bit of a little maybe more aggressiveness. Maybe not so much on this record, but I don't know. It's just, you know, whatever. It's always classic rock. I mean, you know, Run's classic rock too. It always is to me, but done through our weird filters, you know.
I tell you what, I'm just fascinated by everything going on in the room that you're currently in. Everything you've got.
Oh my God. Oh my God. Let's look around.
Oh, can we?
There's the Bee Gees. There's one of those bad 80s hauling ass posters that all that your funky uncles had in their garage. I just had to have one. There's Bowie. There's a cuckoo clock. Yeah, that was a gift from Dave Navarro.
No way.
And there's Rod Stewart and the Jeff Beck group era. And then there's Jane's Addiction up there. And then there's Chevy Metal. And then there's Boston. There's me and Dave. There's a poster with just me and Dave that I just had to have in here.
Very nice.
There's someone gave me that Jerry Garcia thing. I don't even love the Grateful Dead, but I like them enough to put it up there. There's Missing Persons, Aerosmith, Bowie. Here's one of my prized sort of possessions in here. That's Roger Taylor, Fun in Space. And he signed it to me, to a spiritual brother, Taylor Hawkins. Taylor to Taylor, or to a spiritual brother, Taylor to Taylor. Roger, 2006. And then there they are as their little dandies on their back of their first Queen record. There's Alex Van Halen. There's the Police, Bowie.
Wow.
Motley on their first record or second record. There's a timpani drum.
You got some good stuff.
Oh, dude, it never ends. Oh, one of my new prized possessions, dude. You know, me and Dave Navarro are best friends now, so look at that, dude.
Whoa.
That's a one and only, dude. And he only had it for a couple months, and then he got rid of it because he needed some fast money back in the early 90s. And then he ended up getting it back later. And he came over here and he looked around and he was like, you know, he's got like really nice art in his house and stuff. And I, of course, just have a bunch of rock and roll memorabilia everywhere. So
I like what you've done with the place.
Yeah, it's fun, man.
It looks good. I've got to ask you, you know, obviously you've got the new record, Medicine at Midnight, coming out February 6th, which is hugely exciting. I listened to the whole thing today. And I've got to say, grinning ear to ear from start to finish, which I don't always get that with an album.
Or even a Foo Fighter record, probably. No, this is, I mean, you know, there's a few dark, understated moments. You know, Waiting on a War is pretty cathartic and a dark theme. And No Son of Mine is heavy. And Shame is actually kind of dark. But you know what I think? I think that the songs are short. And the album is short. And I just think that there's something to be said for that of getting, and the songs are not 6 minutes long or 5.5 minutes long, you know, and which we kind of started to become guilty a little bit, I think, on some of our last couple records of not really doing this self-editing that maybe we could have done, you know? And although I do like the long journey, Take You on a Path, you know, Band on the Run, Bohemian Rhapsody, Jane's Addiction, 3 days. I love that aesthetic. I do, but I do also love a three and a half minute song. You know, there's nothing like it, you know, and when you can do it right and yet still have enough creative stuff and sounds in there to keep it always ever sort of moving forward in some way, but still continuing to have a pop sensibility, which just Dave just has in his fucking, unfortunately for us, he's got pop sensibility in his
he's fingers, good at that.
You know, whether it's a drum lick or a guitar lick or a fucking, or a big stadium anthem howl, you know, he's just got that thing.
And it feels like a really upbeat album as well, which I noticed. I thought that's, you know, really good with everything that's going on in the world. You know, January is a particularly bleak month. Well, it is certainly here in the UK. It's cold, it's dark, it's damp, it's miserable.
And everyone's locked down again.
Yeah, you chuck in the pandemic, and then all of a sudden you get this record. And I just think it's going to put a smile on people's faces.
Well, that was, you know, that was the because everyone told us not to put it out right now. Everyone, our management, everyone. Like, it's, you can't tour it. All the albums that people are putting out right now are failing. And, you know, I was like, okay, you're the business side, you know. And Dave just was like, no, sorry, I'm putting it out. We're going to put this record out. Because I think if you don't put your album out, you know, because we made this record before the pandemic, like this record's a year old already. And that's too long for us. Especially for Dave, being the chief songwriter, you know, and I think it would have just left him personally in a musical limbo, And I don't even think he'd want to put it out 2 years from now. You know what I mean? Like, oh, I already have two new records. And it's like, and also Dave did say in one of our Zoom meetings with all the management and everyone, you know, he's like, listen, because I mean, everyone's like, well, it's politically not a good time to put a record out and all these kind of things. And although we definitely show our political side every once in a while, we're generally a band to sort of get people together and then entertain them. And that's the sort of basis behind the Foo Fighters is like, we're kind of funny. We have sort of funny videos. Don't take it too seriously. The songs kind of can have a serious thing, My Hero, but they're kind of positive kind of things, mm-hmm. or they're like fight songs like The Pretender, and they can kind of pull people together. Not unlike Queen.
Yeah, well, that's what music is supposed to do, isn't it?
And I'm not comparing us to Queen or saying that we're as good or any of that, but it's that same idea. And Dave has a knack for stadium songs and stuff like that. And Dave's intent when we put this record out was like, you know what? Fuck it. If we can't go play live and do what we normally do, at least, even if it's a small pocket of real Foo Fighter fans, not just the ones who want to hear the hits, but the real ones who are into the whole record. And I don't even know if that even exists anymore. It probably does with our age group.
I think it does with fan base. I think I think
it does with our fan base. Yeah. And I think it does because our fan base, a lot of it is our age.
Yeah.
So we all grew up listening to the record. You know, I was discussing it with my buddy Dave the other day in Navarro, and we were talking about how when you made a record like Janes did and like we still do, and like, you know, you're thinking of it in terms of an album. Maybe all artists are, but we really are, because when we were kids, you didn't even listen to the singles when you put on the album. You fucking skipped the singles because you've already heard it 40 fucking times on the radio. You go right to the beast, the other songs, the weird songs, the one the drummer wrote, Roger Taylor, you know, the Stuart Copeland one, or just the weird one, or just the, you know, the one that, and that's a, I don't know if kids are able to enjoy that anymore the way we do, but I know that kids are getting into vinyl a lot too. My daughter loves it, and you know, they tend to go back and get the Beatles records and the good Bowie records, and then they get to know the entirety of Ziggy Stardust and the Spiders from Mars, and she says, Dad, that song Soul Love is so great. I'm like, yeah. So hopefully with this record and the fan base that you speak of, we'll get to enjoy the whole record,
I think,
you know, and not just the single, you know.
No, I think
it's important. It's on. Yeah, sorry. Go ahead.
No, I think you're absolutely right to put it out now. It's perfect timing. It really is.
It feels that way to us now.
It does.
It really does. It does. It feels that way. I was nervous about it, and I'm always the one who's like, "Oh, this is gonna, you know." But Dave was forthright and solid in his mind to do it now.
That's the good call.
I think it was too.
That's a good call.
That fucker always makes the good call, doesn't he?
but hey,
look at my man cave.
Yeah, well, exactly. I am jealous of your man cave.
Good call, Dave.
It's really good. All my rock possessions are up in the loft. My wife didn't want them out.
Trust me, dude. When we bought this house, this is a guest house, and we'd live out in the outskirts of LA so we can get a little bit more space, kind of like Surrey or somewhere like that. But when we bought this house, I'm like, can I have the guest house? And she's like, no. And so for 2 years, this place was nothing. It was a guest house that rarely people ever use because, frankly, we have enough bedrooms in our real house. And then, you know, they're out here and there's nothing. There's a TV and a coffee maker and a couch that's not even that comfortable and a bed and like lame, nothing to it. And she went away to New York a couple years ago. That was more than that. I don't know, it was 5 or 6 years ago, and with her friends. And I just called everyone down at the Foo Fighters 606 studio. And I was like, where all my shit was, where all my rock and roll paraphernalia was, and drum sets and amps and guitars. And I just said, bring it up.
Good. Good for you.
And she came home and she was like, what did you do? And all the pictures are like this. And it's just so freaking, it's like a thrift shop. It's like a secondhand store. It really looks like one. And I love that. I love that because I love secondhand stores. And so when my musician pals come in and they can just look at the walls and find different things everywhere. And it's like, oh, there's an old picture of Cheap Trick next to a candle with the drummer from Rush on it next to like,
I love it.
You know, an ABBA picture.
I love how you still got relegated to the guest house, though. My wife is the same. She would relegate me to the shed if she could.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I mean, and if you have that shed, then you should take it.
I am going to.
Take the shed. Take the shed, dude.
My Leonard Skinner drumstick, which I caught at a gig in Birmingham, is going in the shed.
Dude, take it to the shed, man. The shed is all yours. Do you have space in yours? Is it a shed? What kind of shed is it?
It's a shed. It's about 6 foot by 4 foot. It's pathetic.
Well, just make something a little bigger. Are you handy?
Okay. No, not really.
Never mind.
I'll get a man to do it.
Get a man. Are you a pointer? Are you a pointer? I'm a pointer.
You do it.
Yeah.
Anyway, listen, mate. I think I've got to leave it there because I'm sure you've got a lot on today. You've got other interviews and stuff to do. Yeah, just want to say congratulations on the new record. Listen to it all today. People are going to love it. Man caves win.
Man caves win. Take care of yourself. Just don't let it get you down. Anytime you can get out and walk in nature, dude, just do it. I'm sure there's a park somewhere near you that you can go for a walk in it. And you know what? That even when it's cold and raining, I just find that to be like, it really just saves your head.
It really does.
It really does. So get out there and walk on the Thames or wherever the fuck you are. And fucking London's beautiful. England's amazing. It's beautiful and green and lush.
It's just wet and cold right now. It's miserable.
I know it is, but, you know, it's part of the beauty. Look at the green around.
Exactly.
You, you know?
Exactly.
Look at that, because we don't know. We are a lot of times in California, everything looks like it's about to catch on fire, and then it does.
Oops. That's so, Taylor, enjoy. Take care of yourself. Been an absolute pleasure.
Yeah, been an absolute pleasure too. Bye bye, buddy.
Thanks, man.
Oh boy, how do I get off it?
You're still here.